What is the idea that comes to your mind when you think about a break, right? You need a rest, whether it's a break from work or a break from, maybe as a parent, you want to give me a break to my kids because you want them to go away so you can have peace, right? But when I hear this, I think of the little jingle, which I'm not going to sing for you, of the Kit Kat commercial, give me a break, give me a break, break me off a piece of that. See, thank you, Richard. I appreciate you, man. I really do. And so, do you know that there's a proper way to eat a Kit Kat bar, right? There's going to be some of you that are going to come up to me, you're going to get a Kit Kat bar, and you're going to take the entire thing and just bite into it. And we will no longer be friends, because I will have to turn away and walk away from you. The proper way to eat a Kit Kat bar is you take it, and you give it a break, and then you have 1/4 of the Kit Kat bar, and then you eat it and enjoy it, right? And then you break off another piece, and then you eat it. And if you have some self-discipline or self-will, you put the rest of it in the refrigerator. So somebody doesn't have the will, and they're going to eat the entire thing in one sitting, right? But the idea is it's meant to be enjoyed in spats, right? So you can maybe embrace the fullness of the chocolatey goodness, the wafers, the peanut butter, whatever else. I have no clue what's in it. Mostly sugar. And so you can sit there and enjoy this thing, right? Now, in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, we understand what a break is because, well, it's quite literally in our name, Seventh-day Adventist. Because we have this understanding of the Sabbath, and you have likely heard sermons from preachers getting up and saying, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shall you labor and do all of your work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. And you should do so work, continues to explain how to keep the Sabbath day, right? Maybe you've heard a sermon or a teacher go off and quote Genesis chapter 1, verse 2. So the creation of the heavens and the earth and everything in them was completed on the seventh day. God had finished the work which he had created, and so he rested from all of his work. And God blessed the seventh day and kept and declared it holy because it was the day that he rested from all of his work of creation. Maybe you've heard Exodus chapter 31, verses 13. Tell the people of Israel, be careful to keep my Sabbath day, for the Sabbath is a sign of the covenant between me and you, and from your generation to the next generation. It is given to you so that you may know that I am the Lord your God who makes you holy. You must keep the Sabbath day, for it is a holy day to you. Anyone who desecrates it must be put to death. Anyone who works on that day will be cut off from the community. For you have 6 days each week to do your ordinary work, but the seventh day must be a Sabbath day of complete rest, a holy day dedicated to the Lord, and anyone who works on the Sabbath day must be put to death. Pretty strong words, right? You've likely heard a sermon or a talk given that you have to keep the Sabbath. See, very rigorous. Leviticus chapter 23, verses 32. This Sabbath day will be a complete day of rest for you, and on that day you must deny yourselves. This day of rest being from sundown on the ninth day of the month and extended till Sunday on the 10th. Now, this is talking about a very specific Sabbath day. This is talking about the Day of Atonement, right? Deuteronomy chapter 5, verses 12. Observe the Sabbath day by keeping it holy, for as the Lord your God has commanded you, you have 6 days to do your ordinary work, but the seventh day is the Sabbath day of rest dedicated to the Lord your God. Isaiah chapter 56, verse 5 and 6. I will give them within my walls of my house a memorial, a name far greater than the sons and daughters could have given, for the name I give them is an everlasting one, and it will never disappear. I will also bless the foreigners who commit themselves to the Lord, who serve him and love his name, who worship him and do not desecrate the Sabbath day of rest and hold fast to my covenant. Isaiah 53. Keep the Sabbath day. Don't pursue your own interest on that day, but enjoy the Sabbath and speak of it with delight as the Lord's holy day. Honor the Sabbath in everything that you do on that day, and do not follow your own desires or idle talk. Ezekiel chapter 20, verse 12, I gave them my Sabbath days of rest as a sign between me and them. And in verse 20, the same one, and keep my Sabbath days holy, for they are a sign to remind you that I am the Lord your God. Like I said, if you've been in the Adventist church for any specific length of time, you have likely heard these passages and maybe explanations on these passages. And I have this whole idea that Sabbath is a day that we are not able to do a whole lot of things. We have to stop doing these things. I remember back when I was in college, there was a video that went around on this new website called YouTube. Yeah, it was new at one point in time. And it was a video that was, I remember the video starting off, says, "Kids, are you tired of being bored on the Sabbath?" And it sits there and shows them, all like, "Yeah." "Well, you need to get Adventist trading cards." And it was like this whole thing on being, trying to be funny. And it's like, they were trying to trade these cards. It's like, "I will trade you one Joseph Faith for your Ellen White." And it's like, "I don't know. Did your guy have prophetic dreams?" And there was this kind of this dialogue that went back and forth. And the whole idea is Sabbath was meant to be a day of drudgery. We're not allowed to do anything. We got to wait until the sun sets to be able to do anything, to be able to enjoy anything. And when that becomes what Sabbath is, all of the verses that I just read are just rules. And when we boil down the Sabbath to just to what I can and cannot do, I would argue we've completely missed the point and might as well do whatever we want to, because when we have that mentality, we're already breaking Sabbath. But what if there was a deeper meaning to Sabbath than just ceasing from work? That's what we're going to be looking at today when we look at Hebrews chapter 4. Before we get into the actual text itself this morning, let us open up with a word of prayer. Father God in heaven, Lord, I want to thank you for each and every person that's here. Lord, first and foremost, I just want to thank you for your Sabbath as we come here. I am blessed to have this day where we can just rest. But Lord, this morning as we look into the scripture, we want to understand what this rest is and how do we obtain this rest. Because Lord, we are a society that is overworked. And we just thank you for all your goodness and gracious to us. In Jesus' name, amen. A study was recently done on the work day or the work week of the average American. Between 53 and 57% of Americans consider themselves workaholics. And how they define workaholics was working a minimum of 50 to 60 hours a week, meaning that they would check their work email before they would even get out of bed and would continue to work on emails even after they had gone to sleep. We are chronically overworked. Most people surveyed, and over 2,000 people, said they don't feel like they can go on vacation because something at work is going to happen and they're not going to be able to handle it. They're overstressed about work. Of that 50 to 60 some odd percent, 37 to 38% of those say that they work the hours at work because they don't have financial stability and they have to work those many hours. Some of them work so many hours in a day that they don't know where work begins and work ends because they're constantly working. You've probably heard the phrase that you got to hustle to make it, right? This is hugely popular in content creation and social media and the influencer thing. You got to hustle, hustle, hustle. We never have time to slow down. We are a culture that is constantly on the move. Now, in our scripture passage here, in Hebrews, we read, that Jess read for us, chapter 3, verse 9 says, "So we see that because of their unbelief, they were not able to enter into his rest." All right? Now, the preceding context, the passage that was going on before this, all of these passages talked about the Israelites, after they left Egypt, before they entered into Canaan. And it talks about the rebellion, right? And this rebellion was the attitude of the Israelites, but it specifically goes back to Numbers chapter 13 and Numbers chapter 14, where it talks about they were just grumbling. "Why wouldn't you have just left us to die in Egypt? Let us go back. Let's appoint for us a new leader." This was kind of the closing, this was kind of like the final straw, right? They're like, "Why did you bring us out here, Moses? We're going to appoint our new leader." But yet, these people that left Israel, what happened to them? First, they saw the plagues that fell upon the Egyptians. And they saw all the things that God had wrought, trying to bring the Egyptians to him, right? This wasn't just a punishment on the Egyptians. to say, well, look at what you've done to God's people. God was using this to try to win back the Egyptians. And finally, they're like, we don't want anything with you. Get out of here. And of course, we know what happens. You know, you got the story of the parting of the Red Sea. Now, if you were an Israelite and you had seen the 10 plagues fall, right? Most of which did not touch the land of Goshen. Only the first three touched the land of Goshen. The rest of them didn't. If you would have seen God's miracle of the parting of the Red Sea, you'd be like, all right, fine. We get it, God. We're going to follow you. Yet there was disobedience over and over and over again. Not because they weren't following Moses. They were always complaining and grumbling to Moses. And their hearts were still in Egypt. Now, Egypt represents something. Egypt represents slavery. Right? When they went to Mount Sinai, how does the Ten Commandments begin? Before we get to the fourth commandment, and before we even get to the first commandment, what does it say? I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of bondage. You should have no other gods before me. It was a bringing out of slavery. And they had saw miracle after miracle after miracle. But yet, they were not able to enter into the rest because of their unbelief. Now, this rest, as some has equated to, the actual land of promise in Canaan, but we'll get to that. Verse 1 says in chapter 4, God's promise of entering his rest still stands. So we ought to tremble with fear that some of you might fail to experience it. The author of Hebrews, who some argue is Paul, it's contested whether or not it's Paul. I'm going to assume Paul, because I think the arguments for Paul are greater than the arguments against Paul. But Paul is arguing here that I am scared that you will not be able to enter into God's rest. I'm fearful. Like, the word fear is phobia here. There is a deep-seated fear about not experiencing the rest that God has for us. Do we, the leaders of the church, are we fearful that people won't experience the rest that God has for us? What is this rest? What is this rest? Well, the actual word here that is used for rest is a very interesting word. It's a very interesting word, and it means, if my notes will cooperate with me here, the feeling of refreshing tranquility or the absence of tension and worry. Let me say that again. The feeling of refreshing tranquility or the absence of tension and worry. When we experience Sabbath rest, do we experience a refreshing tranquility? Are we absent of tension and worry? Are we worried about what we're going to do on Saturday night? Or maybe we're worrying what we have to do on Sunday? Or maybe we're worried about what's left for us at the office on Monday? He continues. For this good news, and he explains the good news is this, that God has prepared this rest. Interestingly, that God, or Paul, is tying good news, gospel, with rest. Why would rest be important for the gospel? We understand the gospel is, I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. Jesus is that Savior. Where does Sabbath, where does rest come in at that? Maybe Jesus knows that we need a break. But is it the break from physical work? For this good news that God has prepared, this rest, has been announced to us just as it was to them. So the gospel wasn't unfamiliar to the Israelites. We think of the gospel as a New Testament theology, but the gospel was clear even for the Israelites. It was proclaimed or announced. You ever heard the word evangelism? We get the word evangelism based upon this word of the announcement, the proclaiming. But it did them no good because they did not share the faith of those who listened to God. They were not able to enter into this rest, receive this good news, because they did not share the listening. Now, this word for share, I love this word for share. Does anybody here like to cook? What is cooking? Cooking is the combining of ingredients. It's the combining of ingredients. You put in the flour and the egg and the sugar and the vanilla extract and all the different ingredients, and you mix 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 that until you can't pull out the flour. Has anybody ever tried to take a batter of dough, of whatever it is, for cookies or for bread, and tried to pull out the flour and the egg and separate them? Have you ever tried to do that? This is what the word share means. It doesn't mean just me telling you and you listening or hearing. There's a distinction between the word listen and hear. It means to share means to mix so thoroughly that it cannot be unmixed. So how many of you are going to go home this afternoon and try to make a batch of bread and try to mix everything together and then try to separate the egg from the flour? If you do, I want to know about it because this is going to be funny. You're going to have a hard time. Michelle, you're not going to do this because you're going to be at my house and we have to clean up. So I don't want you to try to take it apart. We're just going to eat the bread you make, okay? They did not share in the faith of those who listened. And this word for listened is a direct connection to not just listening. It's like a hearing. It's listening to obey. It's listening to obey. I can give you the instructions on how to make a Kit Kat bar. Well, I can't. I guess I could Google it and try to find out. I have no clue how to make a Kit Kat bar. But if I was to give you the directions and you listen, and then you go in the kitchen and try to do it and completely do it the wrong way, and instead of having a Kit Kat bar, you have a pile of gump that nobody would want to eat. Because you didn't. You can listen. You heard me give the instructions. But the end result is different. This happens in the church all the time because we don't actually listen and obey. We just hear what's being said and don't apply what's going on. Verse 3. For only we who believe can enter into his rest. So how do we enter into God's rest? There has to be belief. There has to be belief. And then it goes on here to quote from Psalms 95, right? We're not going to have time to go in and really dig into Psalms 25. Psalms 95 verses 7 and 8 specifically are tied directly to the rebellion at Kadesh. And this is what the sermon, the author, again, presumably Paul, is writing about. That's why we have the scripture reading for that one, because we're not going to have time to go look at that. But go look at Psalms 95 more in depth after this. Even though the rest of the world has been ready since he made the world. Or even though this rest has been ready since he made the world. This is a direct allusion to Genesis chapter 2, verse 2. He ceased. Now this word for rest here also has the idea of cessation, right? Stopping completely. God rested from his completed work. Now this is important. He rested from his completed work. He's no longer working. Now, we all know, does God get tired? No. And we often talk about this rest that he rested with Adam and Eve. That was the first thing that they experienced, was their first full day alive was resting. Were they tired? Maybe the being created part was tiring for them. Maybe going through and naming the animals was tiring, whatever. They weren't tired. It was meant to be a relationship. But it was meant to be a symbol as well. A stop from working. Continues on. We know it is ready because of the place in the scriptures where it mentions the seventh day. And by the way, that's why I like this. Because here he's about to say two phrases. The place where it says this and the place where it says that. He doesn't quote where it says, this is from Genesis. He doesn't say that. He doesn't say, this is from the Pentateuch. He's like, it said somewhere, right? That's kind of my mind. It's like when I'm preaching, like, I know what the verse says. I just don't remember quite the reference. So I really like Paul. There's another place where Paul sits there and writes, well, I baptized nobody among you. Well, except for this person and that person. Well, and there's this person. Well, you know what? I don't remember how many people I baptized. I'm so glad they didn't have typewriters or computers. They had delayed space, because I resonate with Paul so much, because I see Paul as being just as scatterbrained as I am, right? And this is what he's sitting there. This is what he's kind of saying here. There's this one place where it's written, right? He knows where it's at. He knows what he's talking about. And he's making this allusion. Now, we have to understand who the book of Hebrews is being written to. It was being written to Christian Jews. Now, there were Gentile Jews, or Gentile Christians, and there were Hebrew Christians. These Christians would have already known about the Sabbath, right? They would have seen these connection, these word plays that he's doing here with this idea of rest, of sensation, and tranquility, right? Stopping from your work so you can experience peace. Tranquility is another word for peace, right? So God's rest is there for the people to enter. God's completing and stopping his work is now ready for all of us to be able to enter into this idea of Sabbath, of rest, of stopping, of tranquility, of peace. But those who first heard this good news failed to enter because they disobeyed God. Right? Verse 3, it tells us that we can enter the rest for those who believe. Those who don't enter into rest disobey. Well, the believing, the listening, means at the root obeying. So obeying, we enter the rest. Disobeying, we don't enter into the rest. Now, is this talking about that they keep Sabbath or not keep Sabbath? I'm not going to answer that question just yet because we're going to get there. Don't you love it when somebody tells you and they don't give you the actual answer, right? Your teachers that tell you to figure the answer out on yourself, well, I'll give you a little bit more of the answer later on. So you'll still get there, but come with me now. So God set another time for entering his rest, and that time is today. God announced this through David much later, and this was centuries later. About 3 centuries after this happened is when David come around. So apparently, they didn't enter into that rest. Now, did they go into Cana? Yes. After Moses died, Joshua took them into the promised land. But they still didn't enter that rest. So that rest wasn't just a place. There's more to this rest than just a physical place. Right? There's an obedience that has to happen. So God set a time and entered his rest, and that time is today, meaning this day, now. Right? He's talking to his Hebrew Christians, that rest is still available, right? Today, when you hear your voice, don't harden your hearts. We have to obey. Verse 8. Now, if Joshua had succeeded in giving them rest, God would not have spoken about another day of rest still to come. So Joshua did not help them enter into the rest. Do you think they kept the Sabbath day during Joshua's time? Yes. Do you think the Jews kept the Sabbath from the time they were given the commandment to remember, because it was something that was given at creation? Do you think they kept the Sabbath? At any point in time, do you think they kept the Sabbath from the time the Ten Commandments was given until Jesus was talking during the time of the first century? Yes. But according to the Paul, they had not entered into rest. What does this tell us? That you can keep Sabbath and not enter into the rest. You can keep Sabbath and still not enter into God's rest. But Paul wants his listeners who keep Sabbath to understand how to enter into that rest. Verse 8. Now Joshua had succeeded in giving them this rest. Sorry, Jonathan, didn't mean to jump ahead there. God would not have spoken about another day. Verse 9. There is a special rest. Notice how that in the New Living Translation is special rest. That's actually the first time we ever see the word in Greek, Sabbath. In fact, the author of Hebrews scholars agree that he actually probably coined this idea of Sabbath in the Greek language, right? this idea of Sabbath, to rest, a special rest. Now, this is not a noun like the Sabbath. This is to Sabbath, right? So there is still a special rest. So there is a special rest still waiting for God's people. God still has an intentionality for giving us rest. Giving us rest. For all, verse 10, for all who have entered into God's rest have rested from their labors or their work. The physical, the cessation, right? The stopping. Just as God did after creating the world. Now let me ask this question. Is God still creating? Not in the sense that he did during the creation week, right? There's arguments that God's still creating because he's creating us a new heart and all this kind of stuff. But his actual act of creation was done, and he rested from that work. And we ourselves are called to rest from our work. What kind of work are we to rest from? Are we to rest from our schoolwork? Our administrative and teaching responsibilities? Our work out on the farm or in the calf or wherever the case may be? Or is there more to this rest from work that's going on in Paul's mind here? And then he goes on and completely starts to switch gears, right? Excuse me, in verse 11. So let's do our best to enter into the rest. But if we disobey God, just as the people of Israel did, we will fail. Right? So verse 11, we will fail if we disobey God and not keeping his Sabbath as a verb, not a noun. The rest of the places where it says rest is a different word that means the sensation, the tranquility, the stopping and the tranquility. Maybe the reason that we don't have rest is because we're still working even on Sabbath. And no, I don't mean that we're going into work. I mean we are still working. God is asking to give us a break. He wants to give us a break. We need a break. But did the Jews in Jesus' day keep Sabbath as a memorial to creation, or was Sabbath a work to earn salvation? Listen to me very carefully. Is Sabbath meant to give us rest where we cease from work physically, or are we to rest from trying to work for our salvation? I'd like to suggest the rest that Paul's talking about here is not necessarily the Sabbath as a day to stop, but that we should stop trying to earn our salvation because Jesus has already done that for us. We have to Sabbath from our own earning our salvation. And when we do Sabbath, a verb, on the Sabbath, noun, we are remembering that we cannot earn our salvation. You do not earn salvation by keeping the seventh day Sabbath. You do not earn your salvation through prayer and good works. And if we are not truly resting on Sabbath, physically, mentally, emotionally, maybe it's because we have not truly rested spiritually. And that spiritual overflow of tiredness is affecting the rest of our bodies, because we believe that we are created in the image of God as a holistic human. Mind, body, soul, everything in tied is one thing. So if we are resting on Sabbath physically, maybe even we're getting an emotional break on Sabbath, but we're not getting the spiritual break because we think that in keeping Sabbath, we are earning something from God that cannot be earned. We are still working even on Sabbath. Are you following? Does this make sense? For the word of God is alive and powerful. There's still an obedience to keeping Sabbath that's required. There's still an obedience to listening to God's word and actually putting those things into action. There's still that. But it's not the action in and of itself that is the work. The work is when we think that we're doing it for God, so God can then give us something. See, I think when we try to Sabbath to earn salvation, we're taking the Kit Kat bar and taking a big bite out of it. That's not the way it was intended to be. Now, if you do that with a Kit Kat bar again, get help. I mean, it's okay. Eat it the way you want to eat it. This is just a candy bar. But if you are trying to come to church on Sabbath, if you stop on Sabbath just because you think this is what's going to earn you goodness in God's eyes, stop. Break it off. Give me a break. Don't bite into it. Sabbath was meant to be made for man. Jesus says, "Come to me all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest." He's talking to people who keep Sabbath about this because they're still trying to work and earn their salvation. Let us cease from trying to earn our salvation through whatever means. Sabbath is incredibly important. But maybe instead of trying to prove that Saturday is still valid and Sabbath is the seventh day of the week, and we try to earn something through this, let us truly just rest. When I was doing my undergraduate in college, I was a theology major. And there were theology majors that, hey, I'm doing my homework, it's in Bible, so that must mean it's okay, right? Now, whether you do Bible homework on Sabbath, I'm not trying to argue whether or not you're supposed to do Bible homework on Sabbath. Because sometimes I will give you Bible homework on Sabbath, not in those that are going to be in junior Bible. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about church. I'm going to give you, I already gave you some homework today. Go home and read Psalms 95, right? Which is the basis on what Paul is preaching about here. But what I would do is I would just stop. And I would not feel guilty about not working. Because guess what? The church is still going to keep moving even if you don't do that thing that you think you have to do. Because this church is still God's church. It's not my church. It's not your church. Of course, it is my church and your church. We take ownership of the church. But ultimately, the church is God's church. God wants you to Sabbath. He wants you to stop. Stop trying to earn your way. Stop trying to do it in your power. And let God do it in His way. For the Word of God is sharp, is alive and powerful. Sharper than the two-edged sword, cutting between the soul and the spirit, between the joint and the marrow. It exposes our innermost thoughts and desires. I'm keeping Sabbath because I want to please God. Or, I'm keeping Sabbath because Sabbath keeps me. Because if I don't keep Sabbath, then I go down the worldly route of trying to do everything and earn everything. You cannot earn something that is being given to you freely. Am I the only person here that when somebody tries to give me something, I try to give them money, even if it's a gift? Or if somebody gives me something inadvertently, I feel like I have to give them something back. If you invite me over for dinner, I will feel obligated to invite you back over for dinner. Right? This is just the way my mind works. I try to tell myself, don't do that. And if I ever invite you over for dinner, which all of you will be invited to my house at some point in time for food, because I like to cook and I like to feed people. So everybody's going to get invited. Don't all come into my house at Sabbath afternoon because I don't have enough food in my refrigerator to feed everybody that's here now currently. But everybody will eventually get invited over to my house for something. I completely forgot where I was going with that. I had a purpose in that, but food, I'm hungry, okay. Innermost thoughts. When we give for the sake of giving, when we Sabbath for the sake of Sabbath and what God has already done for us, then we can truly rest and have that tranquility and that peace. But when we Sabbath because we think that we owe it to God, we're not truly Sabbathing. And this is the reason that they did not. Now, did every single person not Sabbath? But as a whole people, they did not. They did not Sabbath. Nothing in all of creation is hidden from God, even your intentions on why you keep Sabbath. Everything is naked and exposed before his eyes, and he is the one whom we are accountable. We are called to keep the Sabbath. There's plenty of places in Scripture. If you love me, keep my commandments, right? We see the Sabbath as being a sign in Revelation, right? Sabbath is incredibly, incredibly important. Don't keep Sabbath because you think it's going to save you. Allow Sabbath to keep you in God. Let it give you a peace that passes all understanding. So what I want you to do is go to God in prayer and say, Lord, give me a break. Break me off a piece of that Sabbath rest. That probably isn't going to go anywhere as far as the commercial is concerned, but God, give me that rest. And I want more than just the physical rest that I give on Sabbath. Lord, I want that spiritual rest of knowing that I cannot earn my salvation. Help me to stop working for my own salvation. Now, that's different than working out your salvation with fear and trembling, which is also scriptural. But stop trying to work for your salvation. Stop trying to earn something that has already been bought and paid for a price. Jesus paid an incredibly high price for you, for your soul, for your being, for who you are. Stop trying to earn it. And allow the rest of God to give you a peace that passes all understanding.